Good morning, church family. We're glad you're here to worship the Lord with us today. And it's good to have Madeline here. She's going to be playing an arrangement of Be Thou My Vision, that Irish tune and text that we sing once in a while, but one that has a powerful message, especially as we begin the worship time today. Be Thou My Vision, Lord. Be that vision of my heart. Help me to see you clearly. Help me to know you, to think of you, and meditate on you with joy. And may you be my best thought this day and throughout this day and night, because you are the light that shows us the way. That's what this song is all about. As we begin worship, may you meditate on that.
That was beautiful. Will you please stand with me and join me in our call to worship? Call to worship this morning is from a Charles Wesley hymn, O Come and Dwell in Me. O come and dwell in me, Spirit of power within.
Bring the glorious liberty from sorrow, fear, and sin.
Hasten the joyful day, which shall my sins consume. I want the witness, Lord, that all I do is right.
According to thy mind and word, well pleasing in thy sight.
I ask no higher state, indulge me but in this.
And sooner or later, then translate thine eternal bliss.
Thank you.
Let's remain standing as we sing, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
So much, and go ahead and take your seats. And good morning, everybody. It's so good to see you in worship this morning. I want to welcome you, and especially if you're visiting with us today, really glad that you've come. I'm sure you've already been warmly welcomed, but just want to do that on behalf of the whole church family, and I'd also like to greet those who are joining us online. Really pleased that you all have joined us, and as we're getting started in worship, I'd just like to highlight two or three announcements. And then we're going to have a time of for the new members to join our church family. We had a really fun new member gathering on Wednesday, and there are 12 folks who are going to be joining our church family over the three services this morning. So we're excited about that. And then we'll pray and have our greeting time. And so if you would, I'd just like to call your attention to the bulletin there. We're going to focus on that inside right-hand panel, if you don't mind. You'll see that our Wednesday night lift series is continuing. We started this last week, and there are classes, and there's dinner. We'd love to be able to break bread with you, and if you'd like to join us for dinner, If you'll let us know either by signing up online or calling the church office by noon tomorrow, that would be great. That way we'll be ready for everybody. Also, I want to invite you to mark your calendar for Run for the Roses, our marriage ministry event. This is for married and engaged couples, and you see the details there about that. And you can sign up for this on our church's website. And then finally, I want to celebrate with you down toward the bottom of the page there. You'll see a little blurb about our giving toward the Dynamic Life Ministry. And all told, the Lord's enabled us to support the ministry with a gift of $50,000. And so praise God. Yeah. And I tell you, you know, this is especially important this year because as the Lord put spiritual leadership, put leadership for Dynamic Life before our church family, the calling that we felt was to really make this a ministry of faithful churches in the community. But developing those relationships takes a little time. And so for our church to be able to support the ministry, especially this year, was really vital as we're developing those relationships with other churches. So I want to say thank you, and I want to say praise God. God is good, and God's doing a great work in the lives of these men, and we give thanks to Him for that. So with that being said, I'd love to invite any of those who are joining the church family at this service to come on up. Linda's going to come up and join us. And I've lost my microphone. Karen found it for me. Thank you. All right, thanks. Yeah, this is handheld too, James. Come around this side. And we'll let you all introduce yourselves and say hi to everybody.
Good morning. We are John and Carolyn Wright. We recently retired and moved here from Habit of Grace, Maryland. Here full time, and we're very excited about joining this church.
Amen.
Hi, I'm Linda Jackson. It's good to be here. I think this is my sixth Sunday. All right. So anyway, I'm just enjoying your church, and now I am an official, a part of it. So it's our church.
Amen. Amen. We're so
you
glad.
Probably haven't seen Linda because she hides back
yeah,
here.
Yeah, that's
piano.
Right.
But this is all. She plays beautiful music for us every Sunday.
Yeah, amen. And yeah, we can. Yeah, sure. And we have, as I'm sure you remember, two questions of membership. And I just encourage you in your heart to reaffirm these, because the first one is, do you believe in Jesus Christ, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord? And if so, your response is, I do. Amen. Amen. And the second question is related to the church family, and that is, do you support the church family, will you, with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? And if so, your response is, I will. Amen. Amen. And if you would, let's join together in prayer. Oh Lord, we're so grateful for our church family, and we're so grateful for the truth of your word, because we just experience it, and we're experiencing it now, Lord, that you take folks and you place them in families, that, Lord, you draw us together and you give us your spirit to fill us with your love, and you give us the mission of Christ to live out together. And we're so grateful for these servants of yours who this morning, Lord, have come forward, and as your word calls us to, they've made a public profession of faith in Jesus Christ, and they have become a part of our family. You've called them here, Lord. We believe that. We pray you'd bless them in every way. And all of this we lift up in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, how about a warm hand of welcome? Yeah. God bless you guys. It's so good to have you here. God bless you. And we'll have our time of greeting. So if you're nearby, please do welcome our new church family members.
Well, you did very poised.
Marching
church.
And
all of us.
Well, good morning, everybody. And make your way back to your seats, if you will. It's good to see you all, and feel like a little bit like a kid wearing his dad's clothes this morning. This is my first time wearing a robe in service, you know. But hey, it's exciting for me. We're going to enter into a time of prayer, but I want to bring some families to your mind and ask you to be praying for them. Charlie Black and Sandy Shields are both in the hospital right now, and I ask you to be praying for them. We want to express sympathy to Dylan Roberts on the passing of his father, Ron, on Friday. We'd also like to express sympathy to Tony Sides, then the Frampton family, and to Jackie Kinneman on the passing of Paula on Thursday. So keep those families in your mind this week, and please be praying for them as we go before the Lord in prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, this morning we ask for your Spirit to empower us to cling to truth. We are so easily swayed one way or the other, so quick to listen to anyone or anything that offers quick and easy answers. Lord God, our hearts forget you, so that when we come up against anything that challenges us, Lord, we forget your truth. Your truth. That is what we cling to. That is what we ask of you this morning. We ask because we do not want to lend an ear to anything that challenges who you are or who the Spirit is. Lord God, you are the one that pulled us out of our sin and set us on a path toward reconciliation and joy. How could we waver? How could we go anywhere else? Your Spirit is who keeps us in step with you. Your Spirit is the one that allows us to believe your truth and live it out. Let the truth of your word and your gospel dwell in our hearts so richly, so deeply, that we would never question our circumstances or lose heart within the glorious purpose that you've given us. Lord God, we are yours and yours forever. We ask that your Spirit would testify to that from within us, so that we may never doubt that you have redeemed us and that you are redeeming the world. God, we come to you this morning praying this in your name, in the name of your Son, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let's sing together one more time this great gospel song, Stand Up for Jesus. Let's sing.
you so much. You can take your seats. As we move into our offering time, I'd like to offer you this word from the Lord. It's actually in our journey through the Bible readings this week, and you'll, of course, recognize this as from the cross. But the other criminal protested, "Don't you fear God even when you have been sentenced to die? We deserve to die for our crimes, but this man hasn't done anything wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus replied, "I assure you, today you will be with me in paradise." And I'd like you to ask you to key in on this word, deserve. This criminal, the penitent criminal on the cross beside Jesus, brings up this issue: what is it that we deserve? And it's in understanding what we deserve that we truly understand then what Jesus has done for us, how he has truly opened paradise for us. Though we didn't deserve it, though we had sinned, we had broken God's holy law, separated ourselves from God, he has nonetheless made the way for us to know eternal life in Jesus Christ. And I tell you, life is a lot better, isn't it, when we go through it not with a sense of entitlement, but with a sense of profound and utter joy and gratitude. Friends, this is why we do the offering during the service. It's not just because we all happen to be here. It's because we're giving in gratitude. We know what we deserve. And we know what Jesus has done, what God has given. And we give thanks to him by our very offering, not only of these gifts, but of our lives to him. Amen? Amen.
One day when sin
if you would, please pray with me. Oh Lord, we offer these gifts to you with deep gratitude, Lord, for everything that you've done for us, everything you've given us, and especially for the gift of your Son, our Savior Jesus. In his name, Lord, we pray that you would bless these gifts, bless our very lives as we make of ourselves, Lord, a holy and living sacrifice unto you. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. You can take your seats. And thank you, choir. That was a great blessing. Do you know what some churches have lost sight of? Is that it doesn't matter how many times you talk about the gospel of Jesus Christ. It never gets old. It never stops filling your heart with the knowledge of the love of God. You could sing about the gospel all day long, and it would just bless you every moment of it, man. It is. Anyway, amen. Amen. Got two scriptures today. First, we're going to read from 2 Corinthians and then from the Gospel of John. So if you would, first give ear to the reading of God's Word in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 1 through 4. I hope you will put up with a little more of my foolishness. Probably ought to say that every Sunday. Oh, man. Please bear with me. For I am jealous for you with the jealousy of God himself. I promised you as a pure bride to one husband, Christ. But I fear that somehow your pure and undivided devotion to Christ will be corrupted, just as Eve was deceived by the cunning ways of the serpent. You happily put up with whatever anyone tells you, even if they preach a different Jesus than the one we preach, or a different kind of spirit than the one you received, or a different kind of gospel than the one you believed. And then to John 14, to these words of Jesus. If you love me, obey my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate who will never leave you. He is the Holy Spirit who leads you into all truth. The world cannot receive him because it isn't looking for him and doesn't recognize him. But you know him because he lives with you now and later will be in you. No, I will not abandon you as orphans. I will come to you. Soon the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Since I live, you also will live. When I am raised to life again, you will know that I am in the Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. And if you would, please join me in prayer. Lord, we're grateful for your word. But we know the truth of your word as we read, it is holy and inspired, alive and active. That you, Lord, intentionally send forth your word and it does not return to you empty, but accomplishes your purposes. And so, Lord, we pray that you would do that just now. As you send forth your word, Lord, speak into each heart and mind just what we need to hear so that we might know more of you, more of the truth of the gospel, and that our lives would more fully glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're starting a new sermon series this morning on the Holy Spirit. And I'll tell you what, you know, after Easter, I was looking through the scriptures that we're going to be reading in the journey through the Bible coming up, and we've just started 2 Corinthians now, and we're going to be reading from Ephesians and Galatians. We're going to get to the Gospel of John, and I was reading through and praying through and asking God, you know, where is it, Lord, that you want us to focus? And I'll tell you what. Part of the reason that I want to kind of get ahead of all of that reading is, man, as I'm reading along, I'm just seeing the Holy Spirit again and again, like virtually on every page, meeting the Holy Spirit there in the scriptures. And what I felt the Lord pressing on my heart is that he would want us to focus in on knowing and experiencing more of His Spirit, more of the Holy Spirit. The Lord, you know, really just feel this like urgency and this sense of importance that we would expect and that we would pray for and that we would be open to, yielded to the ministry of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And I tell you what, you know, knowing and experiencing the Holy Spirit is life. You know, when Jesus talks about an abundant life, full life, that is because of what Jesus did and through the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Think about what the Scriptures tell us, and we're going to dig into all of this, but think about what the Scriptures tell us about the ministry of the Holy Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit. He is the one who makes the truth of God real to us, who makes the truth of the gospel real to us, confirms the truth of the gospel. The Holy Spirit pours the love of God out in our hearts so that we experience fellowship with God, His deep love for us. It is the Holy Spirit who empowers us, who comforts us, who leads us, who transforms us more and more after the image of Christ. And this, listen, this is why the Christian faith, and that is to say, salvation, this is why salvation is not just intellectual. It is that, right? The Christian faith, salvation in Jesus Christ is true intellectually. It is. The Christian faith has what we could say is the most explanatory power. As we look at the world, as we look at our lives, the Christian faith has the most explanatory power to explain how it is, why it is that things are as they are, that we are. More than any other religion, more certainly than no religion at all, the Christian faith is intellectually true, but it is more. The Christian faith, salvation, is more than just judicial. That is to say, we do come before God in Jesus Christ, completely washed of our sins. It is as though we have come before the judge, and the judge got down off the bench, went up on the cross, and took the punishment, the penalty for our sins. And so the judge can declare us innocent, but it is more than that. Because not only does the judge declare us innocent, he doesn't just say, you're innocent, you can go, you're free to go. He says, you can stay. You can come home. The salvation that we have in Jesus Christ is more than just intellectual. It is more than just judicial. It is relational. It is the experience of life together with God as His child, as a friend of God. And that is, friends, experience through the work of the Holy Spirit. And this is why, by the way, that the true church is absolutely dependent upon the Holy Spirit. This is not just a human organization. Where you see a church that is trying to move, to work, to live by human wisdom, strategy, ideas alone, that church is dying or already dead. It is through the work of the Holy Spirit that we're able to declare the gospel. The work of the Holy Spirit conforms the truth of the gospel. The Holy Spirit woos people to the Lord, enables us to plant these seeds of faith that the Spirit then gives life to. It is the Spirit who enables us to love each other. The Spirit who gives us this joy together in His presence. It is by the Spirit that we live as a church. And listen, the Lord tells us in His Word that everybody who comes to belief in Jesus, everybody who trusts the Lord, is given the gift of the Holy Spirit. That's what the Word says. And we believe the Word of God, so we believe that that is true. But I will tell you this. It is yet possible for us to resist, disobey, stifle, ignore, harden our hearts toward the ministry of the Holy Spirit. We are very well capable of that. And I'll tell you this too, from what I've seen, and in fact what I've experienced, we can ignore the ministry of the Holy Spirit. We can miss the ministry of the Holy Spirit simply for lack of knowledge, not understanding who the Spirit is, not understanding how the Spirit works in our lives. You know, in 2 Corinthians, our passage there, Paul is very concerned for the Corinthian church. And you see why. He's very concerned about the church receiving, accepting false teaching about Jesus, about the gospel. But don't miss this. He is very concerned because the church is accepting false teaching about the Holy Spirit. These false teachers, they're leading the church into confusion and idolatry. And Paul knows that it is vital that the church understand who Jesus is, who the Holy Spirit is, and the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I just have to say personally also, I know what the Holy Spirit has done for me. I have experienced the love of God poured out in my heart. I have actually experienced the Lord telling me, I did this for you. I went to the cross for you. I have experienced reading the Word of God and the Spirit of the living God applying the truth of the Word to my life, saying, I know, I see what you're going through, and this Word, this living Word is for you. I have experienced the presence of God in the midst of His people, the sweetness, the joy of the Holy Spirit. And I will tell you this, I long for every person to experience what I have in the Spirit. But here's what's much more important than that, is that God longs for you to experience the truth of the Holy Spirit. God longs for that relationship. You are the joy set before Jesus Christ. You are the reason that He endured the cross and its shame. It was so that He could have this intimacy with you, this relationship with you through the Holy Spirit. And so what we're going to start today is just simply with this. Who is the Holy Spirit? And, of course, the question implies the first point, and that is that the Holy Spirit is a person and not a force. We are not asking what is the Holy Spirit, but who. So in John 14, Jesus is preparing the disciples for the time when He will no longer be physically present with them. That's what He's doing. And He is explaining the gift, the promise of the Holy Spirit. He says this, He is the Holy Spirit who leads into all truth. The world cannot receive Him because the world isn't looking for Him, doesn't recognize Him. But you know Him because He lives with you now and later will be in you. No, I will not abandon you as orphans. I will come to you. Now, I want to ask you to notice, first of all, that as Jesus is talking about the Holy Spirit, He uses the masculine personal pronoun, right? He. He doesn't say it. He says He over and over again. Now, of course, there are lots of ideas about the Holy Spirit. And to be honest with you, you know, like when we sing the doxology, we sing the Old English, right? And this can be confusing for people in our day, right? Because we sing Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Well, okay, we know what that means, but for some, does it not like call to mind like an apparition? Maybe cloud, smoke, Charlton Heston, you know, with like fog machines coming out around him, that's the Holy Spirit. There are some who think that the Holy Spirit's a bit like, it's kind of like the Christian version of the Force in Star Wars, right? Like there's just this force, there's this spiritual force in the universe, and if you're a really spiritual person, you can like channel that force. And you hear people say things like, I'm spiritual but not religious. And that's an expression of this, right? There is this sort of vague spirit, they think, in the universe, and I can kind of channel it. And I promise you, Star Wars came out when I was a kid. And I went around for some time trying to move things with my mind. I thought this would be an awesome thing if this could happen. And so I, you know, really straining, and I will tell you, nothing happened. My mom did get a little concerned about me at one point. You know, that's too much of this, but the Holy Spirit is not a force. We hear things like the Spirit being compared to wind or the breath of God, but we know, of course, those are metaphors. The Spirit of God is a person, and the Holy Spirit is God. Not just an emanation from God, but the Holy Spirit is himself God. You notice that Jesus, he speaks like interchangeably about himself and the Spirit. Did you notice this? Interchangeably. Jesus says, I'm going away, but I will come to you. I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm coming to you, right? And he is clearly talking about the Spirit's presence in their lives. As a matter of fact, one of the ways that Scripture refers to the Holy Spirit is actually the Spirit of Christ. The Apostle Peter in 1 Peter, he says, this salvation was something even the prophets wanted to know more about when they prophesied about this gracious salvation prepared for you. They wondered what time or situation the Spirit of Christ within them was talking about when he told them in advance about Christ's suffering and his great glory afterward. So the prophets, the Scripture says, are not writing on their own. They are being led by the Spirit. And here the apostle clearly calls the Holy Spirit the Spirit of Christ. Friends, we learn from the Scriptures, this revelation about who God is, that God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That God is triune. That God is one God in three persons. This is not to say that God is three separate gods, not at all. And neither is this to say that God is one God and God just sort of acts or pretends to be or moves as this person this time, that one that time. This is to say that God is three persons in one being, one substance. And I will tell you, from our finite perspective, with our finite minds, we cannot fully understand what this means. It's kind of like C.S. Lewis talks about this, and he said it'd be a bit like if you could imagine a two-dimensional being trying to comprehend a three-dimensional being. And this is what we're trying to do when we're trying to understand, how can one be three and three be one? How can God in his very character and nature be like this? But what I want to ask you to do is consider the personal significance of Jesus' words. But you know him because he lives with you now and later will be in you. Jesus promises that the Holy Spirit, the third person of God Almighty, will be in you. And I will tell you the truth, I don't know how to get over that. I don't know how anybody doesn't hear that and that they are not shocked and thrilled at the same time to think that the God of the universe, the one true and living God, the God who created all things, the God who is from everlasting to everlasting, lives in you. How do you ever get over that? And some will say, well, of course, he's in you. He's in everybody. He's everywhere, right? God is omnipresent. And that is true. There is nowhere in the universe that God is not present. The farthest reaches of the galaxy, yeah, he's there. But this is different, friends. Is he not speaking here? The impartation of his attention, of his love, is this not about God's personal presence when he declares that he will live in us? Is he not speaking of his manifest presence in our hearts? Is this not an expression, friends, of the deep and abiding relationship that the Lord wants with us? And so next, what I want to ask you to consider is what this means about God's love for us, that he declares, Jesus declares, that the Holy Spirit is another advocate. Think about what that means with me. Jesus says, "And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate who will never leave you." Now, of course, if we're being given another advocate, if the Holy Spirit's being called another advocate, that means what? It means we already had an advocate before the Holy Spirit. And I will ask you, you know, who that is, but you already know, of course. It is Jesus Christ. He is our advocate. You know, the word advocate in the scripture here, it's the Greek word is parakletos, and it means one who is called alongside, right? It's actually used most often in a legal setting, that you have a parakletos, a friend in court. You have an advocate. You have a counselor, right? One who stands beside you. And this is the very same word that the Apostle John uses of Jesus in 1 John 2:1. He says, as the Spirit leads him, "My dear children, I'm writing this to you so that you will not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate. We have an advocate who pleads our case before the Father. He is Jesus Christ, the one who is truly righteous. He himself is the sacrifice that atones for our sins." Jesus Christ is our advocate before the Father. He is our advocate interceding for us, Scripture says, in heaven. Even right now, he lives to intercede for us. He is the one. He is the one who has healed the separation because of our sin, because we rebelled against God, because we decided that we'd rather be little gods ourselves. We'd rather have our own little kingdoms than be a part of God's kingdom. We exchange the glory of God for idols and our own glory. But Jesus Christ has interceded for us with his own blood. He has taken our record of sin and he has replaced it with his perfect record of righteousness. And the scripture says even now he's interceding for us. He's applying the truth of the cross to our sin even now. And this is how, friends, this is how this shift happens that Jesus is talking about. This is how it happens. You notice, of course, that Jesus says, right now, the Holy Spirit is with you, disciples. But there is coming a day when the Holy Spirit will not just be with you, he will be in you. How does that shift happen? It happens at the cross of Jesus Christ. As you see, before that, the epicenter of the presence of God was where? It was in the temple, of course. And not even just in the temple, but specifically in the Holy of Holies. It was believed, and this is true, that sinful man cannot come into the presence of God and live. And so there was this room. This is where the presence of God dwells. And we're going to curtain it off with a thick curtain because we know we can't go in there. We can't go into the presence of God. And so there was only one man who got to go in there one time a year. You probably know this. The high priest went into the Holy of Holies one time a year on the Day of Atonement to atone for the people's sins. But you remember, of course, what happened on the cross of Jesus Christ. In the moment that he died, that curtain in the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, indicating that by the cleansing of Christ's blood, we are made holy and righteous before God. We can now enter directly into his presence, and thanks be to God, his presence, his Spirit, can now enter into us. Christ has made us into a holy habitation for the Lord, a temple. Our very bodies, a temple unto the Lord. Jesus has done this. And now he tells us, I'm sending you, I'm asking the Father, and he's going to send you another advocate, the Holy Spirit. And so imagine this, picture this. As Jesus intercedes for us in heaven, so it is that the Holy Spirit is our advocate dwelling in us, our counselor, our comforter, dwelling in our hearts. And so finally, if you would, let's look then at the Holy Spirit and how the Holy Spirit is the bond of love. Jesus says, "Soon the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Since I live, you also will live. When I am raised to life again, you will know that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you." How is it, friends, that God's love is made real to us? How is it that we actually experience the relationship that Christ died to restore us to? How do we know that? How do we experience it? It is by the gift of the Holy Spirit. As Christ is applying the truth of the cross before the throne of God in heaven, so it is that the Holy Spirit is applying the truth of the cross to our very lives, in our very hearts. Jesus says, the world isn't going to see me any longer, but you will. And because I'm raised from life, you will know what is really life. That is to say, you will know real relationship with God. You will experience, you will know what is friendship with God. Do you know the expression of the Trinity in the Scriptures is the only way that the declaration of 1 John chapter 4 can actually be true. 1 John chapter 4 declares very simply in three words, I bet you remember this one, God is love. How can that be true? What does that mean? I will tell you that apart from the truth of the Trinity, apart from understanding the very nature of God, we can't understand how that could be true, because of course, love requires an object. How can you say that God is love? Before we were created, who did God love? Now you could say that love was a great idea that God had, and so he became loving, but love requires an object. And what we learn from the Scriptures is that God is a holy, divine relationship, that God is eternally love, that it is innate to the character of God, that he is love. He is a holy, divine relationship. The Spirit loves and glorifies the Son. The Son loves and glorifies the Father. The Father loves and glorifies the Spirit. And here's this truly amazing thing. God made us to enter into that relationship, to glorify him and to love him, to delight in that relationship with him. But as a human race, we listened to the tempter. It'd be better if we go our own way, become our own little gods with our own little kingdoms, and live instead for our own little glory. But friends, Christ has opened the way back for us to get into that relationship again. The Apostle Peter put it this way in 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 4, that we in Christ are partakers of the divine nature, participants in the divine nature. Listen, the Father sent the Son to die and rise again for us. The Father and the Son sent the Spirit that we might be personally and eternally bound to him. It's through the Spirit that we can love and glorify and delight in the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We can know the life that we were actually made to have. But here's the thing. This life requires that we would give up our old life, that we would submit our little kingdoms to his, that we would give up on our own glory and decide to live for the glory of Jesus Christ. Jesus says here in John 14, if you love me, obey my commandments. Friends, if the very nature of God, God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, is that God the Spirit loves and glorifies the Son, and the Son the Father, and the Father the Spirit, and so on. If that's the very nature of God, how in the world can we be partakers of the divine nature, participants in the divine nature, if we are determined, if we are fixated on the love of self and of our own glory? The Apostle Paul, he says, I'm afraid. He is afraid in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 that they will give up their pure and undivided devotion to Christ. He is afraid, based upon hearing false teaching, that they will fall back into the temptation that Eve fell under. But I fear that somehow your pure and undivided devotion to Christ will be corrupted, just as Eve was deceived by the cunning ways of the serpent. Disobey God. Become like your own little god. Live for your own little glory, but there is no life in that. There is no life in sin and rebellion and separation from God, friends. Life is found as we yield, as we surrender, as we give ourselves over to love and glorify the Lord Jesus Christ, bound to him by the Holy Spirit. And so, friends, let us allow ourselves to be bound to God by the Holy Spirit. And I just say, friends, as we close, if you've never said yes to Jesus, it is not complicated. It is quite simple. It is to say yes. Jesus, I see what you've done. By your cross, you've made a way for me to come back into relationship. That's what my heart is longing for. Forgive my sins. Welcome me in. Bind me to you by your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And if you would, please, let's join together in prayer. Oh, Lord, we are so grateful for all of the gifts that you give us, but especially right now, we want to give you thanks for the gift of the Holy Spirit. That you, Lord, would not just be with us, you would be, of course, but that you would actually dwell in us. That you would minister to us in such a direct and personal way leaves us in awe of you, God. And so we just simply want to say that we are yours, we yield to you, we do love you. And so we yield our very lives to you. We direct our lives to your glory, to love you, to delight in you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our closing hymn is a prayer. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Stand with me, please, and we'll sing.
If you would, receive this word from the Lord from 2 Corinthians chapter 1, beginning in verse 20. For all God's promises have been fulfilled in Christ with a resounding yes. And through Christ, our amen, which means yes, ascends to God for his glory. It is God who enables us, along with you, to stand firm for Christ. He has commissioned us. And he has identified us as his own by placing the Holy Spirit in our hearts as the first installment that guarantees everything he has promised us. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen. Go in peace.